Good morning, everyone. And again, it's a pleasure to be with you. Your French brother is really happy to have the privilege to open the word. And as you know, it's not my an easy task for me to speak English. And more than that, I need the Spirit of God. So that's why I invite you to pray with me and to bow to our Father in heaven. Our Father in heaven, we are so thankful to be your children. And right now, we come before you to ask you, your Holy Spirit, so that we can discern the sign of the times as you ask us through Jesus. And we need your presence. We need your enlightenment. We need the awakening among us. And so please work these things in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As you can see in Matthew 16, verse 3, Jesus was presenting something to those who was listening him. And he was saying in Matthew 16, verse 3, that, and even in verse 2, but the verse 3, which will interest us. He said in verse 2, and answered and said unto them, when it is evening, ye say it will be fair weather, for the sky is red, and in the morning it will be full weather today, for the sky is red and lowering. O ye hypocrites, can ye discern the face of the sky, but can ye not discern the sign of the times? So Jesus expects us to be able to discern the signs of the time, especially when we are able to discern the sign which are in the sky, right? And I'd like to invite you to turn with me in Luke chapter 17, verse 28 to 30. Where are we going to go now?
Luke
17:28-30. Okay. And there you read. Likewise also, as it was in the day of Lot, they did eat, they drank, they bought, they sold, they planted, they built, but the same day that Lot went out of Sodom, it rained fire and brimstone from heaven and destroyed them all. Even thus shall it be in the day when the Son of Man is revealed. And interestingly, in the book of the epistle of Jude, Jude 1 verse 7, we read something about that, which is related to what we read here. Are we going to go now?
Jude 1:7.
Right, that's right. Jude 1:7, and there we read, even as Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities about them, in like manner, giving themselves over to fornication and going after strange flesh, are set for an example, suffering the vengeance of eternal fire. There was in those cities sexual immorality. And you know, I was pretty amazed to see that your country, you know, which is a country where the president is swearing upon the Bible where he started his office, you know, that the gay marriage, you know, declared legal across the U.S. in historic Supreme Court ruling. And, you know, over the world, you can see that we have other countries which are following that same. In fact, your country followed this manner. And
Australia.
We have this, yeah, I think Australia is missing, but because the chart is from 2015. But what I want to show you here is that the countries which are involved in, you know, the promotion of sexual immorality are countries where Christianity, you know, are implanted, you know. And so this is pretty interesting to notice that. And we are living today, nowadays, we are facing to this situation where we have Australia here. Yeah. So, and I was, yeah. So, and I was say, and I was speaking about your country, but my country did it too. And, but we have, I can say that we have some excuse because,
yeah.
So even though we were the first daughter of the Roman Catholic Church, but after that, the spirit of atheism came in my country. But anyway, we can see that we are in this day today. And so countries where so-called Christianism were implanted are promoting this. And this is, you know, just the beginning, I would say. This is, you know, there is an agenda behind this.
Yes.
There is an agenda behind this. And Jesus also, and now, we're going to go to the book of Matthew, verse 24. And we're going to stay there until the end of this presentation. Are we going to go now? That's right. And I would like to outline some events that Christ presented. And especially in verse 6 and 7, where we read, "And ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that ye be not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet." Some of you have heard about your country wanted to get into wars with the North Korean. And I will not, you know, you are more aware than me about the situation and the tensions which are involved between these two countries. And you should also be aware, and I did not put slides because the file would be too heavy for the web conference, but there is also wars in, you know, Israel, which are ongoing, and in Syria. And in fact, I have an image of that. Yeah, okay, sorry. I just put one image to show you, you know, the locations, you know. And this is from an official website. I think it's the Daily Mail, something like that. And we have, you know, wars all around the world. And when we listen what is going on, we have some struggles, which are some conflict between country. And these things is going on, friends. These things is just going on. And in verse 7, Jesus continue in Matthew 24 in saying, for nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famines. Famines. There shall be famines. So this is in French, so I will translate that for you. But basically what he's saying is that the United States,
United Nations,
thank you, and the EU, the European Union, so they realized, they published a study where they, in which they show that the population, is it English? That's what, yeah, population which are starving all around the world in 2017, and this population is 124 million of human being in 51 countries, and especially in Africa and Middle East. So that's a lot of people. And there is also Venezuela, and Pastor Elvis was talking about that because he is living close to. But these things are going on. And I was amazed to realize that, because today we are living in a world where we have so agriculture, this so-called agriculture, and which is immoral agriculture. But we claim now as human being to be able to fight against this. But the more the time is progressing, the more these things is, you know, continue to exist, and it is increasing, okay? So we are living in such a time, friends. We are living in such a times. And in verse 7, Jesus continued in saying that there will be pestilence. You know, pestilence here come from the Greek word loimos. And this word loimos means a plague, and literally a disease. Mm-hmm. Disease. And I didn't put any slide for pestilence for sure. Let me tell you that. Okay. Because there are too much things to say about that. But some of you have maybe heard about Ebola in Africa. And some of you maybe have heard about the disaster that this disease caused there. Thousands and thousands of people died from this disease. Malaria in India. Maybe, I don't know if you have heard about that, but people in Caribbean heard about that. Chikungunya.
Yes.
You heard about it?
Jamaica,
yeah. And people in West Indies, Caribbean, there was severally, you know, visited by this disease. And we have also Zika. You heard about that?
Mm-hmm.
Zika, yeah. And cholera in Africa, in Asia. So, again, we are living in a world where the science is still making progress, but we are facing these things. And thousands of people are dying of this. And it's in such a time that we live, friends. It's in such a time that we live, that we are living, I would say. And Jesus continues in saying that there will be earthquakes. And in another place, and in fact, in diverse places. It's not only earthquakes, you know, somewhere, but in diverse places. So earthquakes are not only increasing in frequency. So Jesus didn't mean that earthquakes will increase in frequency, but it will also appear in more and more diverse places. And there is many websites which are tracking. There are website tracker of earthquakes, and this is one of these websites. And I found a data on it, and where, you know, the last 365 days, this earth, we counted 50,000 earthquakes on this earth. That's a lot. That's a lot. Just during the preceding year, the 365 last day, 50,000 earthquakes. That's a lot. And in diverse places. And in fact, on this website, and this is one of them, you have a maps, and it gives you the location of all these earthquakes. And you know, what is amazing? It's the earth is trembling more and more. But it seems that the more the earth is trembling, the more God's people are sleeping.
Yes.
And that's why I want now to continue with Sign of the Time in the Christian world. Because at the beginning of this presentation, I started to tell you that, you know, country where Christianism was implanted while promoting sexual immorality via the gay marriage. But Jesus continues, and it's not me who want it like that, because Jesus continues. And in 11, look at this in 11. And many false prophets shall rise and shall deceive many. False prophets. I'd like to tell you something about that before getting to the news, I would say. Let's go to Malachi, and keep your hand in Matthew 24, and let's go to Malachi chapter 4, verse 5 and 6. Are we going to go now? That's right. Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. And he shall turn the hearts of the fathers to the children, and the hearts of the children to their fathers, lest I come and smite the earth with a curse. When we read Luke 1:17, it says that John the Baptist came in the spirit and the power of Elijah. And when we look at this, we realize that there was a work characterized by the spirit and the power of Elijah before the first coming of Christ.
Yes.
Okay? And when we read after in Acts 3, verse 21, it tells us that this work must happen before the coming of Jesus. In fact, the work of John was for the restoration of all things,
yeah.
when you read in Luke 1:17. And Acts 3:21 tells us that this thing must happen, but before the coming of Christ. Okay? And, you know, when we look at the coming of Christ in the Revelation, especially in Revelation 14, verse 14, just before that, what do we have? We see messenger, symbolic messenger. And it's really interesting because in Revelation 10, verse 10, John, he said to take the little book, to heat it, and then he will have a bitter experience. And then the angel said to him, continue to prophesy. And we know that John, in such in Revelation 10, is representing the Advent people, the Adventist people. So the Advent people, the Adventist people, will preach the threefold message, and especially the third one, are represented by God as to be a messenger who prophesy. So, and there are therefore there are this final Elijah. The seven-day Adventist people, the last message for this world is to be preached in the spirit and the power of Elijah the prophet. And you know, when we look at Elijah, the first Elijah, we realize that he had three enemies. Three enemies. The first were King Ahab, his wife Jezebel, and the false prophet. And in fact, Ahab was the civil power. Jezebel was the head of the false religion. And the false prophet was her tool to control the civil power, right? Did you get it? Okay. And for John, it was the same thing. John, whose work was characterized by the spirit of the power of Elijah, he also has three enemies. Herod, the civil power, his wife, Herodias, which used her daughter to cut the hand of John the Baptist. Yes. And she used her daughter to seduce her husband, Herod. And friends, it's the same for the final Elijah. He has three enemies, three opponents: the dragon, the beast, and the false prophets. The false prophet, singular. Because if there is a people who is characterized by the spirit and the power of Elijah, there is also a people who will, that Satan will use as a counterfeit of that work. Did you get it? You should. You should. I hope so, you should. And you know, concerning the spirit and the power of Elijah, I would like us to consider two verses in the New Testament about that. First of all, let's go to 2 Timothy chapter 1 verse 7. Where are we going?
2 Timothy 1:7.
Okay. I'd like to present you what is the spirit and the power of Elijah. Because sometimes we just don't get it. We just don't realize what does that mean to have the spirit and the power of Elijah. I'd like to ask you a question, first of all. Are you Advent people? Are you preparing yourself for the second coming of Christ?
Yes.
What?
Yes.
Oh, okay. And second question, are you preparing your neighbors for the second coming of Christ? Okay. Let us read 2 Timothy 1, verse 7, where we read that, for God hath not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. And do you know what is this power that we have? The power of Elijah. Go with me to 2 Corinthians 13, verse 8. Where are we going to go now? That's right. 2 Corinthians 13, verse 8. And just to tell you that the root word for power in 2 Timothy 1:7 is dyname in Greek. Yeah, dyname. And this is the same root word that we will find in 2 Corinthians 13 verse 8. And I will tell you which word is translate or which come from dyname. And in 2 Corinthians 13 verse 8 we read, "For we can do nothing against the truth, but for the truth." Here, I like the French version. Do you know why? Because the French version tells us here that we have no power. We have no power against the truth, but for the truth. And the word that the King James Version used for dyname is can. So we can do nothing. And that's why the French version said we have no power against the truth. So that's why Elijah the prophet, his work was to restore, because God gave him his spirit and his power for the truth and to restore all the truth. So as with Elijah and John, the work of the Advent preachers, the work, and I repeat it for you, as with Elijah and John, the work of the Advent preachers will be and should be characterized by a spirit of boldness and power only for the
truth.
True mingle with errors.
No.
Only for the truth, my friend.
Amen.
Only for the truth.
Amen.
7 days, the Advent people, those will prepare. And this Elijah, God sent it unto us according to Revelation 10 since 1844, if I have to take this date in account. And you will understand why after I took this date in account. God bring back the spirit and the power of Elijah. But today, the so-called children of this Elijah, you know, in November 2017, this prophet said that National Sunday Law will come, persecution will come, but nothing of that sort is in the pipeline at the present time. Nothing that we have understood. Nothing that we have understood. So I'd like to help this prophet to understand the matter. Because when you read that Poland's leading Catholic bishop has spoken out in favor of an almost complete ban on shop opening on Sunday amid growing public controversy over the proposal. When you read that this mayor, and I think that it's the mayor of New Jersey, says protecting Sunday blue laws will always be his number one priority. So the prophet that I was speaking about is Ted Wilson, okay? He is the president of the SDA Church, a church which by his history is still claiming to work, to have the spirit and the power of Elijah. And this is a claim.
Yeah.
This is a claim. Okay, a claim.
Not actual.
A claim, okay. We're gonna see that in a few moments. But, so, and now, basically, he said in Hope Channel, that, you know, there is nothing in the pipeline according to the Sunday law. And right now, for those who are on phone, I am just, showing quickly, news about Sunday law, how it is progressing. So I just put the first one was published in August 2017, a few months after he spoke. And I didn't put a lot because my file would be too big. But then we show a slide of the mayor of New Jersey, who said that it will be always his number one priority. And we have also in Europe, European Sunday Alliance calls on all its supporters to take action against Sunday work in March 2018. Then you have in Poland too. Poland leads the way in providing an example for the America. And we have also how I didn't put the thing here, but in Europe, you are people who fight back against Sunday trading. So the prophet that we mentioned, you know, he cannot discern these things, it seems like. But why? Why this prophet? Why Ted Wilson with his other prophets are not able to discern these things? I'm going to tell you why. Because when he sent his fellow prophets, it was for shaking the hand of the men of sin. And can you see what I see?
Yeah. Yes.
Class behind. Mm-hmm.
Can you see?
Mm-hmm.
Can you see it?
Yeah.
No. In this image that we are watching, we have Ganon Diop who are shaking the hand of Pope Francis. And this picture, it's from 2016, if I'm not mistaken myself. And how many inches we have between these two men? 0 inches. Keep that in mind, 0 inches. And this is a representative of the SDA Church. Okay? I'd like to ask you a question. There is a claim to restore all things. But do you think that Elijah the prophet would be able to
do that?
Do that?
No.
Do you think that Elijah the prophet would be able to shake the hand of Ahab and Jezebel?
No.
Do you think that John would be able to shake the hand of Herodias?
No.
Do you think that Uriah Smith would be able to do that?
No.
Do you think that James White would be able to do that?
No.
Do you think that G.N. Andrews would be able to do that?
No.
What's happened? What is the spirit and the power of Elijah?
They never had it.
This is false prophet, my friends.
Yes.
But can you see it? Are you able to see what I see?
Mm-hmm. I see it.
No, you cannot see it. No, I'm going to show you why. Whosoever transgress and abide not in the doctrine of Christ have not God. He that abide in the doctrine of Christ, he have both the Father and the Son. If there come any unto you and bring not this doctrine, receive him not in your house, neither bid him Godspeed.
Amen.
Who is John?
Beloved disciple.
Beloved disciple. But how we call it? We call him?
John
the Revelator.
Yeah, but we call him the apostle of love.
Yeah.
But many people cannot see love in that. And do you know why many people cannot see love in that? Because we just don't get what love means.
Yes.
First Corinthians 13, verse 6. What is love? What is one of the component of the love? Tell me. Speak loudly, please.
Does not rejoice
in iniquity, but in the truth. We cannot rejoice in iniquity. We cannot rejoice with those who are rejecting the spirit and the power of Elijah. The truth, my friends. You know, God loves the sinners, but he cannot love sin.
Amen.
And, you know, I'm not telling you that do not shake the hand of people who are believing strange things. People, common people, you know. But the Bible tells us that a teacher, because here he's speaking about a teacher in 2 John verse 1, 9, and 10, those who teach things contrary to the doctrine of Christ.
Yes.
We are not allowed. We're not allowed to shake hands. We are not allowed to do that, my friend. But can you see it? Can you see it? I'm going to show you. The sign of the times, February 19, 1894, part 4. The church that holds to the word of God is irreconcilably separated from Rome. Protestants were once thus apart from this great church of apostasy, but they have approached more nearly to her and are still in the path of reconciliation to the church of Rome. Rome never changes.
That's right.
I'm going to repeat that for you. Rome never changes. Her principles have not altered in the least. She has not loosened the bridge between herself and Protestants. They have done all the advancing.
Yes.
But what does this argue for the Protestantism of this day? It is the rejection of Bible truth, which makes men approach to infidelity. It is a good church.
No.
Why not?
No.
What?
Backsliding.
It is a backsliding church that listen the distance between itself and the papacy. How many inches between them?
No.
How many inches?
None.
Zero. When you have 0 inches between you and the papacy, you are a backsliding church, my friends.
Yes.
And I can show you I can show you many other things like that. And in Brazil, all the general conference meets with different leaders of different denominations, even people who are involved in spiritualism, to shake hands and to give them reward, you know, for their work, for religious liberty. Do you think that Elijah would be able to do that? Do you think that John the Baptist would be able to do that? I don't think so. 0 inches, backsliding church.
Yes.
But, you know, there was the 500th anniversary of the Reformation last year. Mm-hmm. And what's happened? What the false prophet, one of the false prophet who claimed to restore all things did? He go before the dragon, the beast, and the false prophet to say, so, it is a great privilege on this day, 500 years after the Reformation began, when there seemed to be so much instability and challenges in the world, to continue the Reformation in our own hearts. Wilson said in a short speech to 200 leaders gathered for the Reformation 500 years event on October 31. To continue, he said, Wilson says, to continue the Reformation in our own hearts. In our own hearts. To continue the Reformation in our own hearts. When I tell to you, if I said to you that I am walking on this white path, but now I will continue to walk on the blue path, there is a change, right?
Yes.
There is a change.
Yes.
There is a change. Okay. There is a change.
Serious change.
There is a change. I'm going to tell you what is that change. And I will show you what the spirit of prophecy, because it's the spirit of prophecy, we will show you that this change is not for good. Because, and last year, Brother Motzinger wrote that statement. In every generation, in the Great Controversy, page 606, paragraph 1 and 2, in every generation, God has sent his servants to rebuke sin, both in the world and in the church. But the people desire smooth things spoken to them, and the pure, unvarnished truth is not acceptable. Many, and pay attention carefully, many reformers, in entering upon their work, determined to exercise great prudence in attacking the sins of the church and the nation. They hoped, by the example of a pure Christian life, to lead the people back to the doctrines of the Bible. Mm-hmm. But, the Spirit of God came upon them as it came upon Elijah, moving in to rebuke the sins of a wicked king and an apostate people. They could not refrain from preaching the plain utterance of the Bible, doctrines which they had been reluctant to present. They were impelled to zealously declare the truth and the danger which threatened souls. The words which the Lord gave them, they uttered, fearless of consequences, and the people were compelled to hear the warning. So normally, a true prophet, someone or a people who are in which is the spirit and the power of Elijah, the reform starts in their hearts, and it's continue outside. Mm-hmm. And we are continue the reformation outside. But Ted Wilson said that we're going to continue it, but inside.
Mm-hmm. Take it back.
This is not the spirit and the power of Elijah, right, friends. I tell you. And I'm going to tell you why. Because she said, thus the message of the third angel will be proclaimed. You know, a preacher from Australia, and I will not give his name, but he came last year in France and says to the non-Trinitarian people in another camp meeting that we organized, he said that we need to stop to speak about the papacy. Just preach love and Babylon will fall. But Ellen White said that thus, what is that thus? In the spirit and the power of Elijah, we need to speak boldly. I can mention his name. No problem with that.
Who is it? Who is it? We want to know.
Adrian Ebens.
Adrian?
Yeah.
Adrian.
Yeah. And again, and if it is recorded, I invite Adrian to reconsider what is the spirit and the power of Elijah, because you are doing a huge disaster in God's work. May God help you, brother. Thus, the message of the third angel will be proclaimed. Thus, notice that thus. as it was in the preceding paragraph. Thus, that way, not in another way. Thus, as the time comes for it to be given with greatest power, the Lord will work through humble instruments, leading the mind of those who consecrate themselves to his service. The laborers will be qualified rather by the unction of his spirit than by the training of literary institutions. Men of faith and prayer. Do you have faith? Do you pray? It's your work to do that also. A man of faith and prayer will be constrained to go forth with holy zeal, declaring the words which God gives them. The sins of Babylon will be laid open.
Yes.
Will not hid them.
Yes.
We laid them open, my friend.
Yes.
The fearful result of enforcing the observances of the church by civil authority, the inroads of spiritualism, the stealthy but rapid progress of the papal power are not one, not two, not three. All will be unmasked. By these solemn warnings, the people will be stirred. Sorry, thank you. I come from France. Sorry.
You didn't know that.
Will be stirred. Thank you. Thank you for your tolerance. Stirred. Thousand upon thousand will listen who have never heard words like this. In amazement, they hear the testimony that Babylon is the church
fallen.
Really? Mm-hmm. Yeah, the church fallen because of her errors and sins, because of her rejection of the truth sent to her from heaven.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
As the people go to their former teacher with the anger inquiry, are these things so? The minister presents fables, prophesy smooth things, like Ted Wilson, to soothe their fears and quiet the awakened conscience. But since many refuse to be satisfied with the mere authority of man and demand a plain, thus saith the Lord, the popular minister, like the Pharisees of old, filled with anger, as their authority is questioned, will denounce the message as of Satan and stir up the sin-loving multitude to revile and persecute those who proclaim it. This is the spirit and the power of Elijah. I still have 12 minutes. Okay, thank you. You are so gracious. All these things are happening, friends. And yet, some of us believe that it's not yet the time to preach the second and the fourth angel message.
When will it be?
What is Babylon again? Is the church fallen because of her errors and sins, because of her rejection of the truth sent to her from heaven? So when you have a church corresponding to that,
yes.
What is the problem to call that church Babylon?
No.
Those who are not calling such churches Babylon do not have the spirit and the power of Elijah.
Uh-huh.
I tell you. So why do we fear to preach these messages, the second and the fourth angel messages? Are we seduced? Are we sleepy? Where is the spirit and the power of Elijah that should characterize our work? I fear that some of us don't have that spirit and power, friends. And in fact, I can't see how we can say that we have the spirit and the power of Elijah when we go to camp meeting to shake hands of the ministers who teach that God does not destroy. Sin is our nature, and the beast is not the papacy. I'm sorry. But I will say it with love. And I love you all. But those who are doing that, I'm sorry. But you don't have the spirit and the power of Elijah. And God wants us to have the spirit and the power of Elijah. Because we need to preach the third angel's message with that spirit and power. In Matthew 24, verse 12, Jesus says that are we going to go? And then we read, and look at this. Let's read back 11. And many false prophets shall rise and shall deceive many. And right after, look at what Jesus is saying. And because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. Christ gives this sign just after having spoken about the false prophets. So this is connected. Do we realize that the fact of listening false prophets will lead us to iniquity, friends? You don't believe that. But now I will show you why you should believe that. Let's go to 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 10. Are we going to go?
1 Timothy.
Yeah, that's right. 1 Timothy 1:10. And I'm going to show you why listening false teacher leads people in iniquity. And then you will no more believe me, but you will believe the word of God. Because I'm not came from France so that you can believe me. No. I just came to show you the word of God.
Amen.
And because the word of God is the same in France, in US, in Venezuela, in Curacao, it's the same word of God.
All right.
Amen?
Amen.
Okay. Different language, but the same message, the same spirit, the same power.
Right.
1 Timothy 1 and 10. 1:10. And he's speaking here about the law, okay? And verse 8, sorry. But we know that the law is good if a man use it lawfully, knowing this, that the law is not made for the righteous man, but for the lawless and disobedient, for the ungodly and for the sinners and unholy and profane, of murderer, of father and mothers, for murderers of father and murderers of mothers, for manslayer, for warmongers, for them that defile themselves with mankind, for men-stealers, for liars, for perjured person, and if there be any other thing that is contrary to sound doctrine. Who is teaching sound doctrine? Who are they? Sound teacher, right? Good teacher. And when you are teaching good doctrines, you are not condemned. And you are not leading people to be condemned by the law of God. But when you are a false teacher, a false prophet, you are condemned by the law of God. And you are leading people to do the same. And that's why Jesus says that in Matthew 24, verse 12. God will not destroy. Well, I'm safe. I can continue. You know, it's not a big issue. The beast is not the papacy. So it's not a big deal to disregard the Sabbath because it's not the present truth anymore. Sin is my nature. So I can stop sin. So let it be. False. These false teachers are leading our people in sin. These teachers and those who follow them could seem kind, lovable, but don't forget some things, friends. Don't forget that. Love rejoices in truth. So a lake of love for the truth is a sign of love which walks cold. And finally, and And this is the most important portion of the message, but I'm trying to go fast. Matthew 24, verse 14. Where are we going to go now? Let's go back to, that's right, 24, 14. I'd like you to consider that, because maybe some of us did not yet realize that. And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come. Yeah. Thus the end will be preceded by the preaching of a gospel to all nations? Yes. No. But I restart my question, because you said yes. Does the gospel will be preached by the preaching of a gospel?
This gospel.
But which gospel? The gospel of the kingdom. And which gospel at the end of the time are we to preach?
Everlasting.
The everlasting gospel. And can you tell me what this gospel lead us to do?
Fear
God, give glory to him. For judgment is come. In my two last presentation, we consider the gospel of the kingdom, my friend, because we were presenting how to vindicate God's kingdom. And this is the gospel mentioned by Jesus. And this is the gospel, friends. So it's not a gospel. I have my gospel. You have your gospel. This gospel of the kingdom. No, the end will come by the preaching of this gospel of the kingdom. And I tell you, Mark 1:1 tells us that this gospel is the gospel of the Son of God.
Yes.
There is a sister, no Trinity in your song, right? No Trinity in that.
Yeah.
That's right.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. But do you think that this gospel is now being preached to all nations? If we consider the gospel of the Trinity, who is now being preached by the various sects, it's clear that the response is no. But if we consider the preachers of the three angels' message, do you think that this gospel is now being preached to all nations?
It has to be the true gospel.
The true gospel that we preached, that I believe I presented unto you 2 days, during these 2 days.
Yes,
it's going.
Do you think that this gospel is preached by all who claim to prepare God's people?
No.
I'd like to be short, because I just have 5 minutes, something like that. In Gospel Workers, the version of 1915, and the page 486, paragraph 1, to 488, paragraph 1. Ellen White was saying, "Before leaving Australia and since coming to this country, I have been instructed that there is a work to be done in America. Those who were in the work at the beginning are passing away. Only a few of the pioneers of the cause now remain among us. Many of the heavy burdens formerly borne by men of long experience are now falling upon younger men." Notice something here. Notice that the experienced worker here are the pioneers of our message. That's right? Yeah, that's right. So what we're going to read here is addressed, and only addressed, to those who share the truth that God gave to these pioneers. In other words, what we're going to read here could not apply to the apostate Seventh-day Adventist denomination and to its apostate independent ministries, and even to the apostate non-Trinitarian ministry included. This concerns What we're going to read concern those who are in line with our pioneers, friends. And she goes on. This transfer of responsibilities to laborers, 5 minutes, to laborers whose experience is more or less limited, is attended with some danger against which we need to guard. The world is filled with strife for supremacy. The spirit of pulling away from fellow laborers, the spirit of disorganization, is in the very air we breathe. By some, all efforts to establish order are regarded as dangerous, as a restriction of personal liberty, and hence to be feared as popery. These deceived souls, and she called them deceived souls, those who are thinking that, these deceived souls regard it a virtue to boast of their freedom to think and act independently. They declare that they will not take any man so saying, that they are amenable to no man. I have been instructed that it is Satan's special efforts to lead men to feel that God is pleased to have them choose their own course, independent of the counsel of their brethren. In the final work, Satan is seeking to sow a spirit of disorganization in deceiving the laborer, especially the young ones, concerning the freedom. And I take it for myself. And she goes on. Herein lies a grave danger to the prosperity of our work. We must move discreetly, sensibly, in harmony with the judgment of God's fearing counselors, for in this course alone lie our safety and strength. Otherwise, God cannot work with us and by us and for us. God is not with us if we are in disorganization, if we are not acting upon this principle. This spirit of independency is not a small danger for our work. It's not a small danger. No. It's a grave danger for the prosperity of our work. It's not me who says that. And she goes on, oh, how Satan would rejoice if he could succeed in his efforts to get in among these people. Which people? As I said unto you, not the SDA denomination of today, not his independent ministry which are fallen, the people of our pioneers. And I believe that spiritually I am among these people, friend. Mm-hmm. And I believe you too. Mm-hmm. So this is what we are considering here is for us. Mm-hmm. Oh, how Satan would rejoice if he could succeed in his efforts to get in among these people and disorganize the work at a time when thorough organization is essential and will be the greatest power to keep out spurious uprisings and to refute claims not endorsed by the Word of God. We want to hold the lines evenly, that there shall be no breaks down of the system of organization and order that has been built up by wise, careful labor. License must not be given to this orderly elements that desire to control the work at this time. There is a grave danger to promote the spirit of disorganization, friends. But she goes on, and this is why we were considering that. Because she says that some had advanced the thought that as we near the course of time, every child of God will act independently of any religious organization. But I have been instructed by the Lord that in this work, there is no such thing as every man's being independent. The stars of heaven are all under law, each influencing the other to do the will of God, yielding their common obedience to the law that controls their action. And in order that the Lord's works may advance healthfully and solidly, his people must draw together. I have a huge question to ask you. And you need to think about it for a moment, I think. Because this is the basis of what I'm going to tell you. Are we living in the time when a thorough organization is essential for our work?
Yes.
Definitely. Definitely. But are we nearer to the close of time today than in 1915 when she wrote this?
Oh, yes.
So this is for us. And today people are deceived. Laborers of us among us are deceived. But the Lord showed his servants that until we get close to the time of the end, the close of time, we need organization, friends. So yes, we are. We are nearer to the close of time today than in 1915. So what do those who act independently? A work. They are doing a work, but not the one of God. Because in God's work, his children, his people must draw together. And quickly, you know, she continues to say that the spasmodic, fitful movements of some who claim to be Christian are well represented by the work of strong but untrained horses. When one pulls forward, another pulls back. At the voice of their master, one plunges ahead and the other stands immovable. If men will not move in concert in the great and grand work for this time, there will be confusion. What is confusion?
Babylon.
Oh, it is not a good sign when men refuse to unite with their brethren and prefer to act alone. Let laborers take into their confidence the brethren who are free to point out every departure from right principles. If men wear the yoke of Christ, they cannot pull apart. They will draw with Christ. I'm sorry to have this to say here, but when I look to the worldwide people who claim to restore all things before the second coming of Christ, I see confusion. And why? Because we are not weary the yoke of Christ. If it was the case, we should have to move in concert and harmony. If it was the case, moving in concert and harmony would have characterized our work. But instead of that, there is confusion. There is pulling apart. There is that kind of things. But the work cannot be done, cannot be finished, if we do not take this in consideration, friends. So what we saw here is beyond my ministry in France. It's beyond Smyrna Gospel Ministry. It's beyond any ministry represented here in West Virginia 2018 Kent Meeting. It's beyond every ministries which are in line with the fundamental teaching of our pioneers. What we are talking here is about the work the worldwide work of the threefold message that God gave us as Adventist people to give. A true message characterized by the spirit and the power of Elijah. And you know, this is the kind of danger that will prevent us to fulfill the sign of Matthew 24:14. This organization, selfishness. This is the kind of danger that will prevent us to fulfill the sign of Matthew 24:14, because we cannot do nothing against homosexuality, except for ourselves. But we cannot do also nothing against earthquakes. We cannot do nothing against famines. We cannot do nothing against the other sign of the time that we saw. But as for the preaching of the gospel, we can do something. And this is the sign that will bring the end. This is the sign that will show that the end is come. So, do we want Jesus come quickly and rapidly? Do we want his coming soon? Mm-hmm. Yeah. We need to work. We need to be organized in our work. Mm-hmm. Whether we were lay people or laymen or minister or then minister, we need to get organized, friends. And it's not time to sleep. We are not in a time to sleep. We need to finish the work. Amen. As God wants us to finish the work. Mm-hmm. And if you want to finish the work, whether you are a layman, whether you are a minister, ordained minister or not, I invite you to bow with me and to pray. Our Father in heaven, we are so thankful for your word. And through Jesus, you show us what will happen at the end. And we thought the different signs, and we are realizing that we are in this time of the end. And the end is getting closer and closer. And we realize that just before the coming of Christ, the gospel of the kingdom has to be preached. And we are realizing that there is some lake in our work, and we need to be organized, and every one of us, we need to be filled of your spirit. Otherwise, Satan will use us to disorganize the work. So that's why we come before you, and in asking you to help us to do the things that you want us to do, when you want us to do them, and at the moment you want us to do them. So we pray you to help us, each of every one of us, and to help this message that we have to preach, this precious message, and to give to each of every one of us the spirit and the power of Elijah, so that we can bring the message as you want us to bring the message to this world. And it's the beautiful name of Jesus that we came before you and pray you. Amen.